I was wondering how many of you think you had a sense of where the music was going next when I suddenly stopped? Okay, I see some hands, not everyone. I will actually claim that you all had conscious or unconscious expectations about the music. Later on, I will tell you where these expectations come from, and who knows, I might even play the continuation of the piece. What you just heard was the opening of the third movement from the famous Moonlight Sonata by Ludwig van Beethoven, a fast, furious, and truly challenging piece calling for high degrees of expertise on the part of the performer. In fact, we tend to regard the moon on the sky in very similar ways as to how we regard the skills required to perform this piece. So the moon is a distant, mysterious object, far beyond reach to any of us. And to most people, musical skills seem just as unachievable. So how many of you in here would consider yourself as musical? Again, I see some hands, but not all the hands. In this talk, I want to convince you that, in fact, we are all musical beings with an inbuilt potential to become musical experts. So just like innovation and curiosity eventually brought humanity up there to the moon, then also hard work and persistent dedication provide the tools for each of us to become musical experts. So why do we tend to think that that musical skills are so unachievable? Well, I think the reason why is that our thinking is dominated by a romanticized concept of musical genius. For instance, Peter Lichtenthal, a German composer and medical doctor from the Romantic era, describes it like this. He said, "Musical genius is that inborn, inexplicable gift of nature or original faculty to create with facility aesthetic ideas and to give them the most fitting expression in the melodic and harmonic organization of tones." I think what our friend Peter here is really trying to say is that there are five things we tend to think about musical expertise. First, that it's elusive, so it cannot be studied scientifically. Second, that it's innate, so you're born with it. Third, it's all or nothing, so either you have it or you don't. Fourth, it's creative, so it primarily has to do with producing music rather than listening to music. And then finally, it's also believed to be advantageous. So if you have it, you should be grateful, and if you don't, you should be jealous. You might think that this sounds a bit academic, but I will. I'm sure that you all run into this, or you all encounter this romanticized concept of genius in your everyday life. And here's an example from the popular from popular culture. You're probably all familiar with the world-famous TV show X Factor. Yeah? On this show, hundreds of hopeful candidates perform in front of an expert panel. And then this panel's task is to detect the X Factor in the candidates. So what is this X Factor? Well, it's believed to be this extra something that only very few of us are gifted with from the day that we were born. And the rest of us don't have it, and that's unfortunate for us. The lucky few people who do have it, however, they just need to be discovered by the expert panel, and then they will become famous pop stars within a matter of months. So to sum up, X Factor is defined as elusive, innate, all or nothing, creative, and advantageous. So based on research by myself and my colleagues, I will now take you on a journey to explain why all of these five characterizations of musical expertise, or X Factor, are just as wrong as claiming that human beings never walked on the moon. So let's begin. The first stop on our trip is our lab. So welcome to our lab. This is where we run our experiments, and here is what we do. First, we feed an advanced computer model with 10,000 of melodies or 100,000 of musical notes, and this allows us to test different theories about how learning takes place in listeners like you and me. And then we invite these listeners to the lab, we play music to them and see how they respond. Pretty simple. We do this in three different ways. Either by asking them how uncertain they are about what's going to happen next, so a bit like I did at the piano before. Second, we can also ask them how surprising specific events sound to them, or we can measure their brain signals. And when we use these techniques, musical expertise becomes something that we can indeed study systematically in the lab. And when we do that, one of the things that we discover is that the extent to which your expectations fit with the musical style, that increases the more you've taken part in musical training throughout your lives. So just like languages need to be learned, musical styles are also internalized automatically all the time. So of course, we've all been exposed to a lot of music during our lives. So if it's true what I said before, then it must also be the case that you're sort of already some sort of experts. Let me demonstrate. So I will now play the two different continuations of the piece that you heard before. And then I will ask you to say which version is the correct one. Okay? That was version two, one, sorry, of course. Version two. One becomes 4/2, that's right. So how many of you thought that version one was the correct version? Okay. Either you're asleep I don't know. How many of you thought that version two was the correct version? That's right, see? All of you. So this proves, I think, that you do not only have strong expectations about what is going to happen, you can also distinguish right from wrong notes. Being a skillful listener like you guys is, however, only one aspect of musical expertise. In fact, there's no simple answer as to what makes you musical. For instance, you could be good at performing, good at improvising, good at composing music, reading musical notation, playing together with others, or discussing and writing about music, or singing in the shower, or at selecting the best dance tunes for your next house party. So musical beings come in all shapes and sizes, and nobody excels on all aspects simultaneously. Not even the professional musicians that I will now introduce you to. So, dear audience, although you might not be able to play the Moonlight Sonata like I did, we saw that you all already are very skilled in listening to classical music, you can say. And this is perhaps due to the fact that classical music is sort of a style of music that you've all been exposed to before. If, however, we played complicated jazz by the American saxophone player Charlie Parker, then our experiments show that those of you who are non-musicians would probably not really be able to distinguish right from wrong notes. And that's a white bar you see here first. The classical musicians, however, professional classical musicians, can do this just as well as the jazz experts. If, however, then we make it a bit harder and then look at how uncertain people are about what is going to happen, then only the jazz experts are able to introspect about this stylistic knowledge, so access this knowledge that the classical musicians also have. So not only are the jazz musicians superior in performing music, jazz music, obviously, they are also better at some but not all aspects of listening to music. So it has both to do with producing and listening to music. Then you might ask, if the jazz musicians are experts in jazz and the classical musicians are experts in classical music, why don't the classical musicians then just apply their sophisticated knowledge when they listen to jazz? Why don't classical musicians listen to jazz with classical ears? Well, here's the explanation supported by our research. We find that inside your minds, there are cognitive firewalls. And cognitive firewalls separate different musical styles and make sure that you only apply your expectations in relevant contexts. And there are lots of good reasons why evolution has built us in this way. For instance, it would be a bad idea to mistake a tiger for a cat. You all agree? Good. Similarly, it would be a bad idea to mistake the tiger of classical music, Ludwig van Beethoven, for a jazz cat like Charlie Parker. So while these cognitive firewalls prevent us from confusing musical styles, they also mean that our expertise doesn't always generalize. So because expertise is based on deep specialization, whether it's advantageous or not, that depends on the context. So to sum up, we have learned that musical expertise is empirically investigable, it's acquired to a large extent, it's multi-dimensional, and it changes both the way that you perform music, obviously, but also the way that you listen to music. And then it's also highly contextual. So even though the achievements of expert musicians might seem admirable and impressive, that does not make them otherworldly geniuses. On the contrary, because musical expertise is a question of practicing, it essentially becomes accessible to all of us. We saw how musical learning happens automatically in all of us all the time. That makes us musical beings. So you might ask, why is this so important? What's wrong with a good old romanticized concept of genius? Well, here's a picture of my mom. Yes, picture of my mom. Many years ago, when she studied to become a school teacher, everyone had to learn to play the violin. Or, in fact, not quite everyone. Because after a few lessons, my mom was told not to come back. According to her violin teacher, she lacked musicality and she would never be able to master her instrument. So why waste your time on something that you can never learn? My mom followed this piece of advice and never returned to taking up a musical instrument. This example, my mom's example, perfectly demonstrates how this romanticized view of genius, or X factor if you like, can be used to exclude people from musical context or musical activities. And if you stop and think about it, one would never consider excluding people from learning to read or write or from learning a new language just because they found it a bit difficult to begin with, just because it took a bit of practice. On the contrary, we would make sure that these people got extra lessons. So music has been around for at least as long as language. It's one of the key things that makes us human. It distinguishes us from other primates. And it also socially binds us together. For instance, there's a TEDx after party happening right out here, and people are playing music. Why? Well, because music binds people together. So when you exclude people from musical context, you're essentially depriving them of an essential part of what it means to be human, and you might risk making them feel lonely and isolated. And this is why we need a scientific approach, not only to things like reading and writing or second language learning, but also to music, and in particular to musical expertise. So the next time you listen to a piece of music, maybe even the Moonlight Sonata by Beethoven, then keep an ear out for your own musicality. Challenge yourself and discover how you might already know where the music is going next. And remember that musical expertise is within reach to all of us, also to you if you practice hard. Whether he was a genius or not, there's certainly one thing that Beethoven knew for sure, and that is that all his listeners were musical beings. So let's try this out. Let's listen to some music and see if you can hear your own musicality. Guess what happens next?